So the second part in this session is Boolean function with restricted input and regression theory application to the flip cipher. And the talk will begin by Lan Montena.
Thank you, Maria. The motivation of our work is the stream cipher flip. The stream cipher flip was designed by Pierre Méo, Claude Carlet, Anthony Journeau, and François-Xavier Stendhal, and it was published at Eurocrypt in 2016, and it has a very specific design. It has a very specific design as the secret key K is stored in a register that is never updated, and a random permutation is applied at each time to the secret key K. And eventually, a Boolean function is filtering the permuted secret key. And this cipher is adapted to fully homomorphic encryption, as the filtering function F here has a very low multiplicative depth, so it's quite good for fully homomorphic encryption. The filtering function was chosen with this form, so you have a linear part, a quadratic part, and a so-called triangular part. And both those three Boolean functions here have nice properties, they are balanced, they have a nice non-linearity, and the filtering function has also a high algebraic immunity. However, you can notice that when permuted the secret key K here, does not imply that the input of F is uniformly distributed over the whole domain. And in fact, as there is only a permutation of the bit here, that means that the input of the filtering function has always the same Hamming weight. And as the filtering function has always the same Hamming weight, then it's not sufficient to say that the filtering function has nice cryptographic behavior, because the input of F is not uniformly distributed. For instance, if I'm saying that the filtering function F is balanced, then when fixing the Hamming weight might be derived a Boolean function when the output Zi will not be balanced. This is, for example, the case if I'm choosing this Boolean function on four variables, then it has this truth table, and you can notice that there is 8 zeros and 8 ones in the truth tables, but when I'm restricting to fixed Hamming weights, so on yellow it's Hamming weight 1, then the Boolean function when restricted to this Hamming weight is constant to 1, and when restricted to fixed Hamming weight 2, the Boolean function is constant to 0 here. So when we restrict the Hamming weight of the input, then the output can be constant even if the function was balanced and in the first place on the whole domain. And we studied a Boolean function was restricted the input to a given subset, and especially fixed Hamming weight subset. So we defined the weight-wise perfectly balanced function that has a Boolean function that are balanced when we restrict the truth table to fixed Hamming weight subset. So, for instance, for all k, we have to have a truth table where there is half of 1 and half of 0, but only when restricted the input set to fixed Hamming weight. This property can only hold if the binomial here is always even, and this this appears only if the number of variables of the Boolean function is the power of 2. And to have a Boolean function that is balanced on the whole domain, we impose that the Hamming weight that is 0 gives us 0, and the Hamming weight n gives us 1, because there is only one element of Hamming weight 0 and only one element of Hamming weight n. For instance, to give an example, this Boolean function here is balanced on the whole domain, and if you are restricted to Hamming weight 1, then you have 2 ones and 2 zero here, and the same holds for Hamming weight 3, and for the Hamming weight restricted to 2, then you have 3 ones and 3 zeros. So this function is a weight-wise perfectly balanced function, and we aim at construct those functions. We also can generalize the definitions to almost perfectly balanced function when the number of variables as input function is not a power of 2. And we have also some results on the algebraic normal form of the weight-wise perfectly balanced function. We know that a weight-wise perfectly balanced function has to have exactly n over 2 monomials of degree 1, n over 4 monomials of degree 2, and at least one monomials of degree n over 2. And we have similar results for what was almost perfectly balanced function. We have n over 2 monomials of degree 1 if n is even, but this is slightly changed if n is odd, and we also need to have n over 4 monomials of degree 2 in the algebraic normal form of the Boolean function. We know also, and I'm referring to the paper here, we know also that we cannot construct whitewise perfectly balanced function by just adding two whitewise perfectly balanced functions where the inputs are taken independently. But we have modified, we have slightly modified this construction with this construction. So let me explain this. You take n a power of 2 and f prime and g prime three whitewise perfectly balanced function on 2 to the l minus 1 variables. And if you take g prime any function, so if you just want to simplify this formula, you can just take a g prime to be 0, and then you have f of x plus g of y plus the product of all xi, which is the variables of x here. And this function here is a whitewise perfectly balanced function, but with 2 to the power of l variables. So this construction allows us to build plenty of whitewise perfectly balanced functions. And the idea of the proof and why it's working is the following. So you fix y here, then you fix the value of gy, you fix the value of g prime of y, and then if you fix y, then you get this value for the big function, or this value for the big function, depending on the value of g prime of y. Because if g prime of y is 0, then you have f of x plus g of y, and if g prime of y is 1, then you have f of x plus f of x, that means 0, you have g of y plus f prime of x. But you fixed y, and if you are looking with a fixed Hamming weight, with a given fixed Hamming weight, then fixing the Hamming weight and fixing y just fix the Hamming weight of x here. And as you fix the Hamming weight x of here, as you f of x and f prime of x are chosen, y was perfectly balanced function, then this is balanced. And you have only a problem in the proof when the Hamming weight of x is 0 or n, because that means that you have only one element for f of x or f prime of x, and if you have only one element for f of x or f prime of x, then you have to add this product here of all variables, such that the whole function is still balanced on the whole domain. So this might be quite technical, but to be sure, to be more precise, I can give you an example on how to construct those functions. So if I want to construct a whitewise perfectly balanced function on 16 variables, then I can start with the first with two variables, function x1, x2, that is x1, and this function is whitewise perfectly balanced on two variables. Then I can build a function with four variables by just adding f and f and the product of all xy, and this gives me this Boolean function, and recursively I can build f with eight variables, that is also whitewise perfectly balanced. And eventually I can derive f16, and f16 has this form, and you can notice that there is eight monomials of degree 1 here, which was we proved before, and there is also four monomials of degree 2 and one monomial of degree 1, that is 16 over 2. But so this was for the balancedness criterion on the Boolean function. So if you want to have a flip that is balanced when you choose Hamming weight, you have to choose a filtering function that has this form, or at least you have to prove that it's balanced. But the degradation of the cryptographic behavior can also happen for the nonlinearity criterion and the algebraic immunity criterion. For instance, for the nonlinearity, I recall that the nonlinearity of a Boolean function is the minimal of the distance to f to all linear constants or affine functions. That means all function of degree smaller than 1. Then we also define the same properties, but when we restrict the input to a given subset. So if I'm fixing a given subset of F2 to the n, then I can also define the nonlinearity restricted to S of the Boolean function, that is the distance, but when we restrict the truth table to a given subset of entry. And what could possibly be wrong by doing this? If I'm taking this Boolean function, that is sigma 2, it's in fact the sum of all monomials of degree 2, and this function is known as a Planck function on formal level, so the nonlinearity of this function on the whole domain is 6, that is the best nonlinearity we can achieve for Boolean function, but in fact this Boolean function has this truth table, and when you restrict the entry to the, for instance, for the Hamming weight that are equal to 2, then you can notice that the Boolean function restricted to Hamming weight 2 is constant to 1. So that means exactly that when you restrict the input to Hamming weight 2, then the nonlinearity of this function is equal to 0 and not 6. So we gave in the paper, we gave bounds on the nonlinearity when we restrict the input to a fixed subset, and especially because freak was our motivation, we restrict the input to fixed Hamming weight subset, and we finally get this bound here. And moreover, this bound was improved lately by C.M. Ménager in 2017, and also this work is related to the study of the punctured Weidenmüller code of some order, and Tumor and Kapalova wrote an article last year on this subject. Moreover, all the degradation of this criterion can also happen on the algebraic community criterion. So the algebraic community is the minimal of a degree of an annihilator of f or f plus 1, and then here we also define the algebraic community restricted to a given subset S, that is the minimal of all degree of J, such that it annihilates f or f plus 1, but you have to add over s and over s here, because you are restricting over a fixed subset. So that means g of f might be not equal to 0 on the whole domain, but might be only equal to 0 on the given subset. For instance, if I have on four variables, I'm taking this Boolean function, it has an algebraic community 2 in the whole domain, and when I'm expressing the truth table of f, then I'm giving this function. And if I'm restricted to the input of Hamming weight 2, then I have 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1. So if you can notice that if you multiply f by x1, so you apply f times x1, it gives 1 times 0, it's 0, 1 times 0 is 0, 0 times 0 is 0, 1 times 0 is 0, and 0 times 0, 0 times 0. So f times x1 is a null function on the fixed 2 Hamming weight subset, but when you have when you multiply f by x1 here, you recover x1, x2, x3, so this is not 0 on the whole domain. So the algebraic community of f, but restricted, is in fact 1, because there is an annihilator of degree 1. And we aim at another general result, and when we do the same, we add two different functions where the input, where the variables, the input is are taken independently, then we have this property, so that means the function f has an algebraic community restricted to fixed Hamming weight k that is greater than the algebraic community of this function minus the degree of the Boolean function j, y. This is quite counterintuitive, because in the classical setting we have this formula when we add two functions. So this this can be very bad, because when we construct Boolean function to use them in cryptography to guarantee you that you have a nice algebraic community, you can often do this construction to be sure that your function will have a nice algebraic community. But in this setting, when you fix the Hamming weight, this might not be the case, because you can add objects such as the algebraic community in fact is decreasing. We also gave upper bounds for the nonlinearity, but as it's quite technical, I'm referring to the paper here. But let's come back to Flip, because it was the first motivation of our work, and So we gave bounds on the three main criteria for the linear function. So for the filtering function. So for the specific filtering function of flip, then we computed the range of acceptable Hamming weights such that the bias of the output is undetectable for the recommended parameters. We also aim at give a lower bound on the nonlinearity. So we have a formula of the nonlinearity when we have this construction as a filtering function of flip constructed on this with this way. So we have some range of k's such as of some range of Hamming weights such that the bias is not very large. And this was also quite technical, but we managed to prove concretely the exact bounds on the algebraic immunity restricted to k. So in the classical setting, the algebraic immunity of the output function has those values, and in our setting, so in the exact setting we have to study the Boolean function, we only managed to prove those lower bounds on the exact algebraic immunity of flip. So to conclude my talk, so we defined the weight-wise and almost perfectly balanced function. We provided construction for those functions, and we defined the algebraic immunity restricted to fixed Hamming weight and nonlinearity restricted to fixed Hamming weight. We gave bounds, and I'm referring to the paper here. We gave bounds when we do not restrict a fixed Hamming weight subset, but arbitrary fixed subset, and with the properties on the construction when we have two functions, we aim at finding lower bounds on the exact cryptographic parameters of the flip and senses. And which is important to remember here is the author of flip just studied the function in the classical setting, but the criterion they made was not relevant because the input of the function has a fixed Hamming weight. So just to conclude, my conclusion, just be very careful when you are using a Boolean function on a string, on a cipher, because if it's not guaranteed that the input of the function is uniformly distributed over the whole domain, then that means you have to study the function on a complete different setting. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Ian. Are there any questions? I have a question. So have you thought about any other possible applications of your work besides the flip scenario? Any flip analysis, conditional settings, or anything?
Okay, so there is two things. First, the work can be seen as a guideline for designers if someone wants to do a specific design with those settings. But also, it might be possible to link this with some side channel model when there is models where you can have access to the Hamming weight of some register. And if you have you have access to the Hamming weight with certain nodes, so we have to take this into account, but it might be possible to do our work related to this, because if the Boolean function used and you is very bad for some specific Hamming weights, then it might be of interest to use the side channel model when you have access to the Hamming weight of a register.
Okay, and you have not tried for instance, conditional cryptanalysis, with this kind of ideas, you can use weaker conditions.
Okay, so the conditional cryptanalysis, the problem here is that you condition your cryptanalysis with the Hamming weight. That is something that is normally unknown for an attacker. But yeah, if you have access to this, you can do conditional cryptanalysis. And it might be an improvement for a correlation attack. Right? Conditional correlation. Yeah.
Thanks. Are there any other questions? Okay, so let's thank Jan again then.